That is funny.
Yeah, actually, yesterday was great for me because, like, I went in to the office, my internet was broken. They would justify meeting, like, halfway through the workday or whatever. Well, yeah. At, like, 9:30, I had to call on, like, my cell phone, so this is not the work for however long it takes. However long Roger is there. So I went in, and then, like, I had a few hours that I actually got to do things. And then, yeah,
Sabat probably has the majority of it.
Some of it you left
behind. Like the list ropes and things we have. Make sure you take those. So I just think this is fair. If we resolve the lease situation here with Tiffany, not having broken the mirror, she can credit us the cost of the mirror to our next venture.
Yes.
You got it. All of this. Basically, she owes us that mirror.
Yeah. Good. For our good behavior.
Hi, guys.
Good.
He didn't say.
I asked him. I don't think he's able to.
Oh, okay.
But I'm going to meet with him at least one more time. For sure. Mm-hmm.
And yeah, then we dance with sorrows and we close the eyes and whatever it looks. That's fine.
Good.
No sense of easy and stuff like that, right? It's just like frustrating when you're speaking to me, like, that. You feel so good because they know nothing. So every single thing.
Yeah. Yeah, recruit classes are great for an ego success. Yeah. This is a sword. It is.
Right now.
I'm converted to your wrapping method now. Wrapped my aluminum armor. How many shots you end up taking?
Oh,
right, like right here on that.
A lot of them would be like a notch dent from like his arm.
Well, that's what I tell people at parties. But it's just shitty cover.
I've got one on my aluminum sword. It's like, oh my god.
Oh, yeah?
It's like I did it. In the wood.
And
wash.
What it was the throw was coming down, and your finger went.
But yeah.
Yeah.
My hand there at the time, I hope not.
Yeah.
I would have remembered that one.
Yeah, so
we have some like crazy students.
I'm happy to close the chapter on this. We can put our swords down. Oh.
We are doing not swords.
We're doing not swords.
Okay. So, this Fiore class, we're moving all the way through the manuscripts from the beginning to the end. We started, so two classes ago, we started with the wrestling section. We went through the first six plays, I believe. And then, I'm told the last class did the...
You could go the wrong, farming, curing,
and yep.
The poking ear.
And the poking ear, yeah.
And the poking ear.
And a bit of being brought from behind as well.
A bit of it.
Okay. Oh, yeah. Did we need a bit of a stepping behind?
Yeah, we did. You're right.
Okay. Or maybe we
started.
We started. I don't think we did a lot of
that. That was the.
Yeah, that was the.
Yeah, that was this play.
Yeah.
Yeah, the low grab. The low reverse grab. Yeah, from back to
back. Yeah. We didn't have a knee in the ball because I don't think we called it in the end.
You'll remember today. Alright. Cool. Great.
Smart name.
So let's finish up. I think we can get through the rest of it today. Okay? But before we get into the plays, I just wanna propose this way of looking at the arm for the grappling section. And get any feedback. So the first six plays to me kind of seem like the core of this situation, right? There's a universal counter against high grabs. There's a universal counter against close grappling.
Mm-hmm.
And then the elbow push, which pretty much covers the majority of basic stand-up wrestling situations, outside of the straight, right? All of the other stand-up grappling situations that result in breaks, keys, and throws are going to be covered in dead. The rest of the section, to me, seems like a combination of other possible situations and pain compliance. So I would put the fireman's carry, the escape from behind, the gambarolo, the full Nelson as like various situations. And then the rest of it is going to be in some way, shape, or form pain compliance. Poke in the air, the kick the balls, the smash the face push of various kinds.
I guess
the universal counter to close grappling, the shears, the shears. So like whenever you're in a situation of close grappling, the high hand can go to the face, the low hand can stay low, and you can try and shear. And it doesn't matter what the footedness of the opponent is. So you don't have to get me. So in that sense, it's universal. Something you can almost always see. So that's what I think how the section breaks down. I don't know if I'm being a little too dismissive about these other situations, but they do kind of seem random to me. Like they don't necessarily follow from one another, where all of these seem to kind of flow in a logic. So that's why I'm separating. So,
I think we were arguing about some of those last ones that have gotten us that, right? We were kind of like the camera or the fireman carry or whatever.
What do you come about to do then?
Like what is the actual term for
it? Yeah, so let's, I wanted to review it anyway, not use over it, so let's definitely do that. So let's start with the fireman's carry. Okay. And let me start off by saying I have absolutely no idea. I have no opinion on this one really whatsoever. I've never really really had a strong confident belief in how this is done. Having said that, this makes the most sense to me.
You know what?
The getting one I think is drawn wrong almost certainly. It doesn't mean any wrestling logic that I'm aware of.
You're too far from the center of mass.
Why would you bring in the opposite side when you're doing the throw on me? It doesn't make sense. Right? never seen that in any wrestling system anywhere. It's natural to bring in the close-up on the side that you're going into. Yeah. And so that's what the PD shows. So now, I do want to propose two possible things here. So one of them is, this is a Bowism. And Bow had this idea of really focusing on the standing nature of it. Because the typical fireman's carry kind of theme kind of has you throwing them over your shoulder or pulling down, right? Using this height transfer to pull them down onto your shoulder and then flip them here.
So you make him trip over you, so
in order to do this throw, you, in the conventional logic, you want to get their weight on your shoulder.
Yeah.
And it's maybe you can pull them on your shoulder, and maybe you can overbalance them here, but maybe not, right?
Okay.
So that weight change will do it, right? That weight change will do it.
Well, you need to bring their weight above you somehow, and what Arnold does is a hip check to essentially start tipping.
So that's, I think, the conventional way to do it. Bo's way, I think, is much more painful. In Bo's way, he kind of stands up. He stands up,
which is more sport or forceful.
And he'll get you off the ground and then toss you backwards. So he's not really throwing you over the shoulder.
It's more for your form?
It's more throwing like slamming up under you and then throwing you back. So let me just do that to everyone. And keep in mind that I don't care about this.
Yeah, the shoulder and the ribs, right?
But of course the leg is going to be capped.
It is.
Yeah, into that tip.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All
right.
That was roughly what I was trying to do to Leander when Leander fell on my knee after it.
Oh, really? Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Fell on my knee. I don't even know how it was possible, but like. Yeah.
It was a messy drill. That's what happened.
Yeah, but like, so I was actually going for that play in a real life situation. Didn't work out.
Why, it wasn't combat?
Well, it was like, it was
like really
really
true.
Yeah.
Yeah, so. Those are the two main ways that I can see doing it. Was there any additional method proposed last week?
There was a little bit of kind of throwing behind you, sort of thing.
Yeah.
Whether it gets shoulders or like.
Yeah.
Get them on the hips as opposed to.
Yeah, bring them on your lower back, and this is usually like them over. Which was.
It was very much an all over.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. It's kind of like probably you have to gain one. When you got there,
oh, okay.
And you just throw them behind you.
Sure.
Which is it was more the idea of like, the getty is like outside the leg, so
right.
What would fucking happen?
Right.
Which is,
yeah.
Should we fall drawing?
Well, personally, I don't get super hung up anymore on like, what is the exact thing Fiore is trying to show? Because more and more, what's relevant for us to take away are the concepts. So what is this? It's a standing throw. It's a high-low sort of standing throw. How? What are the ways you can do it? Well, probably a whole bunch. Maybe reaching from behind, I'm doing it underneath your crotch. I think that would also work. Have a pain compliance element to it.
You get what you get.
Yeah.
Let's get like hips go high, hands go low.
Oh yeah, that's the thing. Let me read the test again. Yeah.
All he says is I put my hand under your arm.
Yeah, thanks, Chris. But the PD is usually helpful.
Okay, go ahead.
So the getty is not much more helpful. Thanks to the grapple, I have gained. from the ground with all my might. Oh yeah, that is important. I will lift you from the ground with all my might and have you under my feet, head first, then body. You won't be able to perform a good counter to this. So 2 points there to me, all my might and head first, then body. Head first, then body suggests that the throw is somehow like that. Now you couldn't do it another way, but that is kind of...
That's the theory.
Yeah, and all my might, to me, he rarely ever says that. So that suggests that there's a major strength element to it, and that this is something that we're, you know, we're really doing, so. Yeah, it's unique, huh? He doesn't say that very often. All my might. I can't even think of another time he says it. Maybe once or twice more. But anyway, so we can do this a few times if you want. The floors are kind of shitty. So I think we can do it fast. In good conscience.
Last time. Yeah.
Yeah? All right. Well, there you go.
We are like breaking us.
Just as we're, just as we head out.
Just in time.
So, in deference to the floors, we're going to give this a pass in terms of doing to each other.
Uh-huh.
But we discussed that you guys did it last week. Okay.
Thank you.
But while you were in the bathroom, we just pointed out again. Fiore says two things.
Sorry.
He says I'm going to do this with all my might.
Yeah.
Which he doesn't say very often in the book. And also, you'll go to the ground head first, then body, which suggests a tipping.
Yeah.
All right. Cool. Enough said. The poke to the face. So Fiore says, because of my thumb pressing under your left ear, your hold is failing. Which is interesting. He's so specific. And again, he says, oh, I'm pressing my thumb under your ear, giving you so much pain that you'll go to the ground without a doubt. Or else, I'll do another grapple that will bind the worst in torture. The counter is performed by the sixth play against the fifth, which is the elbow position. Okay, so let's do that. So let's do that in our pairs. So what we'll do, maybe we'll get into a bit of a head and arm situation again. And then one of us will go to the ear and press. And then try and get something else.
Right.
Working. I think the way we want to press is with the thumb on the hand. Guys?
That doesn't want the tempo, but it hurts too much.
I think that's what's happening.
Yeah, I think we want to press with the thumb.
You were in front of the ear, which is painful too. I think the place behind it.
Behind?
Yeah, it's behind the ear. Earlobe.
In that little divot right behind the earlobe.
Yeah.
There.
Just painful.
Between the jaw and the skull. Okay.
Yeah.
All right, let's do it.
And the thing is that the follow up to that. Yep, enjoy.
Okay, so stop with here. So two things. number one, just a point about pain compliance. In my view, the purpose of pain compliance is pretty much universal, just to be in tempo. It's not going to rely on the finished fights or do anything really important more than getting tempo for others yet. Number one. And that means also pain compliance, the effect of pain compliance is going to depend on the constitution of the opponent. Maybe they don't give a shit.
Yeah.
Right? And it all depends on what's going on with that. Number two is that it seems to me that the most logical follow-on from the from this poke is on the same side of the poke. So the ear poke happens, the pain sets in, and then you try to prosecute that on the same side. Yeah, exactly. Isolation would be the thing I would go to, but you know, or whatever. Maybe set you up for another strike, right? That has more compliance. You can build on that tempo. Or whatever. You guys are doing that, I just wanted to put say it all. Okay? So maybe we switch partners and do it one more time?
Sure. So this is probably the mediation decrease.
Maybe break them up a little bit.
Yeah, I was there.
Okay.
And then here.
Yeah, because I think
this one here.
Yeah.
Yeah, I should have actually done that. Even with shoulder blade is gonna mess me up.
Yeah. So that's
I'll still do it. Because then you can't come to me. But I think I did on the wrong side before. Or sorry, the less effective side. Because you had your hand on the other side.
Okay, so I'm here. And I tried to do it, but this arm has nothing, right?
Yeah, sure.
This arm.
Yeah, it's fine. In my hand was fine.
So
pick a side.
I did this side before, so this side now.
So my temptation is to go directly to where you are.
And initiate with that.
So if you do the same thing.
This is a really weird.
Yeah, that's too far.
So you basically, it's a long distance. To get the leg.
So yeah, we definitely said it's not sure, but that doesn't make any sense.
I mean, you could be right behind, maybe.
Like that, but now you're on the low ground. Yeah, but then you can just look.
This arm lags a bit. And there's
Even for someone, that's part of the problem, because it's easy for you to know which side is easier.
Well, and then after reaching, when you're that low, not so much.
But that's why I would like drug you to the
thing. Wide enough, that I was having trouble getting my feet wrapped.
Yeah.
Right? So in that situation, right, where it's really wide, you might have to work in some other strategy. Right? You might have to try something else.
Yeah.
Because this one wouldn't work. And I do think that's a valuable observation, that this step behind is unlikely to work if the base of the enemy is too wide. Because the risk of the step behind is always this moment.
Yeah.
Right. Right. So if they're standing like relatively, say, conventionally, right, this makes you pretty stable. This hook, you know, this kind of hooks in, and you don't really feel too bad. But yeah, Bastien's feet, if you were standing wide, and I was like, right, it was.
I think the thing that's going to be true for everything is that you need a distraction. If you try to do the step without having gained some sort of tempo, you're like,
you're
crushed, right? So that's why this is good, and you can really get in your face.
Yep.
And if you poke my knee on the way, I was like, oh, that's a good way to like get something going as well.
And also this sudden distance change. And conventional ways to break out of this hold include stripping, right? They also include working an arm in, right, to break it. There's all sorts of ways that you could, things that you can do to get rid of this, right? And the thing that most people were doing, finding space in here and turning around on it, that seems to me to be the simplest thing.
And it's less risky than...
If there's space there,
No doubt, right? Yeah.
Because you're still in the clinch and you're now you're face to face with that as opposed to that.
You're not getting
you gain some advantage.
It's more like you're equalizing
when
you're getting it.
When you're back before.
Yeah.
As opposed to being behind you, you take the advantage.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Those degrees of
But to me all of that is part of it. I really do think the spirit of this is try this. If you can't do it, do something else.
You gotta be honest. Because if my time is locked in, it's sunk. There's anything you're able to do. But
you have all
the freedom.
Yeah.
For sure.
How do we have a, I know the drawing there, it's like you get the light from under there, but it's kind of a weird angle, right? Like,
but depth is not very well drawn.
Yeah, that's the sorry, because it could be like
Are you like 2 feet away or are you just behind?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a great question. It's it looks close, but
it's pretty
close. There's the loop that this five blocks that five and which helps with the throw, right?
Yeah. So it's just like actually, it's drawn in two views, a side view and a back view.
We're comparing the PD and the Getty, which is kind of interesting. The text isn't helpful, but the picture is interesting. The Getty says it's a trip up, which is not too safe an action to do. So I guess I kind of spoke too soon. That isn't useful. Still, if you want to use a trip up, do so strongly and quickly. And the Getty, the PD says this is a grapple move that involves the gun roll up. Be aware that this move will always, or will not always work. So, this way. I also take this, unsurprisingly, to be not specific to this action specifically, but as a general concept of trip ups. It's very common in wrestling when you have, you're kind of equal up here, and you don't really, you're trying to do stuff, and he's countering you, and you don't really have any ideas, so you're like, well, I don't know, fuck it. you try and, do some games, some light games, right? You're trying to get your heel around there so you can push them over, all sorts of stuff, right? And the there's a myth is the wrong word, but I'm gonna use it. There's a myth, this opinion among Fiore is that Fiore doesn't like to do anything that forsakes his fortitudo in order to get something. There's a couple data points where that comes from, and this is one of them. He says it's not safe to do. Why is it not safe to do? Well, surely that's a comment on the basic concept of the trip up, which is to take my leg and use it to try and trip up your leg, which is stable, right? As soon as I move my leg, I'm unstable. I'm on one foot. And the leg I'm trying to trip is stable. So it's a sacrifice of fortitudo in an attempt to get over it. It can work great, but it's risky in nature if Fiore says it. So he also says it's often not going to work. This is also true because there's lots of space for the legs to move, right? As long as you're conscious with your legs, you can put the leg wherever you need to put it, even if it's disrupted, even if like this heel block is a pretty damn good one. If you block the heel and push them over on it, it can be tough, right? But even, if you're just conscious of it, right, you can pick that foot up and put it back down. And in wrestling, you always have the opportunity to put your foot through on them in case you have a lack of it. You can put some of yours on theirs. So unless they go to the ground, you're going to stay up, right? Which is kind of an interesting little thing. Kind of has hints of a double kill in it, double kill kind of mentality. Mm-hmm. Like
sacrificing my stability to gain advantage.
Well, I'm saying my stability is now out of my hands. But now I'm going to give you the option to throw yours away, throw mine away, mm-hmm. or to keep us both. It's an unideal situation. But in the last moment, if it's a choice between you falling or you doing that, that's pretty safe. It's a safe option, right? Most people will not throw themselves on the ground and just get more stability, right? Most people. So the actual gamble roll, it looks like it kind of looks like a conventional some sort of pick throw, right? Where your inside leg is engaged on the opposite side. And you displace their hip to some degree, and you're going to end up throwing them over your hip, right? I don't think a popular interpretation of this is really to make it about the leg, as if it's something like that, because the leg in and of itself doesn't really have that much force incumbent in it. It's really not that great of a weight transfer, right? Whereas having the leg settle you so that the hip can do it, that's usually more reliable. But I mean, how do we actually do it in cross-ups, right? So in concept, let's try that. Let's try a whole bunch of different ways of doing it. And so yeah, let's do the gamble roll first, and then let's have some fun with some trip-ups after. Okay, look at the top. So, Yeah, so let's do the camera roll. We can try the traditional way, which is kind of pulling from the head in arm position, I would say, right? Right, throwing my phone over. Another Boism that I remember is prepping the throw with a this, trying to get the weight over here, and also open up a stepping area where one may not necessarily have been, right? It's a common actually, it's a common fuck up when trying to do the leg throw, especially against a lead leg, which is what you prefer, to just go for it. And the other person, we haven't prepped it, we haven't right done anything, you just go for it, and the person's like, okay, I'll keep it. Right? I've done that to myself more times than I can count. So a boism is to prep that side, put his weight on this leg, and then go for it. And that's what I'm going to do. Okay? Alright, so do it as best you're able. Be careful you're not to do it forcefully, right? Note the balance. Okay? Go ahead. Oh, we're six now. And yeah, six.
Okay, stop up here. Do you want to share stuff? Yeah.
Yeah, sure. Like one of the things I find could start this play is initiate some form of fourth or fifth play. So some sort of shear, and if you resist, even if you're relaxed, that still gives me that fraction of time where you focused on, you know, going in the direction of that.
Okay.
So
yeah, so we can start this also from something we've already seen. An older, common, not in fashion interpretation of this is to do it from close grappling. Mostly because Fiore demonstrates an over high low grip here. So one of the ways we used to talk about it is coming from this position.
I agree,
it's pretty tight. But it doesn't matter to me. Whatever, you know, it's just one other way to get to it. It's a constant. Okay? I do wanna play around with the trip ups a little bit though. I know we bark at recruits in sticky hands not to do this shit. But you know, that's why you can become scholars if you do this. Let's play around with trip ups. Okay? So what I mean by that is let's do sticky hands-ish, right? Or like stand up, some light stand-up grappling. And let's see if we can find moments to, you know, get their fortitude over the balance by using some light attacks and stuff. Okay? Not limited to little kicks, you can try the gamble also. Any leg focused attack. Let's just try it. And then obviously try and defend it and see how it feels. Okay?
Thanks.
That's part of the question.
Thanks.
Can you set it up? Something else.
Whoop! Yeah, you're right.
Also, if you know this,
No, on the other side. Yeah. So you're trying to do stuff for me. Try and push them on that side.
On that missing side.
Yeah, on the missing side. That's better.
It's not obvious that this is the whole martial art that Fiore did.
Oh, sure.
Right? like there's lots of things that we might do in drills and skills to train and tactics we learn and talk about that we never end up putting in a curriculum book.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Any curriculum book that we would write is going to be necessarily pared down.
Mm-hmm.
And if someone were to say that's the whole thing, then that would be wrong, right?
Well,
not everything you know, but not everything we know.
Yeah.
That's a pretty good argument. He's not putting everything he knows in that book.
For sure. And actually, as a bit of a taster, the study group on Sunday nights, which I know is a shitty time, that's been reading through the Blue to Comp material. It's totally mind blowing stuff for Fiore scholars. Not in like there's amazing plays that are not seen in Fiore, but that it looks pretty obvious that Fiore is plugging into a tradition that's already in Germany. And like some of the pages in this book, which is itself a compilation of other shit, they're ripped right from the Getty. Right? And it's just and some of the artwork is almost identical. And some of the logic flow of it is all said. So you can see that there's an extant tradition that Fiore is already plugged into, and he's kind of taking what he likes from it.
Mm-hmm.
And isn't that neat? So not older, but there's a series of four manuscripts that are referred collectively by the name Blume de Kamp, the flower of battle in German. And the earliest one is roughly contemporary with Fiore, 1420. And this one from 15-something, and this one from 1700. But a good portion of the plays are right from the PD to Getty. Or, I mean, they're identical to plays in the PD to Getty.
I've always teach that Fiore went in with the assumption that you already had. You already trained by your entire life. You already had, like, 10 years of rough experience. And this is in the selling. This is what types of stuff I can teach you. Keep that plan. As opposed to, I'm going to start the training at like 8.
Right.
And just this stuff.
All the basics are already your expected.
Yeah, that is a common belief of Fiore's, and I think it has merit. That this isn't a teaching manual, as if you were teaching people in a school or teaching people with no experience. It's something else. Compilation, greatest hits, resume, it's all sorts of theories. All right. Last one. And we have six people, so this is perfect. We've got two groups. Escape from behind. Escape from behind in the groin shot. Well, actually, let's. Look. All right. Let's just draw the board around this stuff right now. The groin shot. The ear poke. Face push, the eye gouge, all that shit, pain compliance used to get other plates, used to do other plates.
Like face push shots, depending on how you do it, depending on the face push you're looking at.
Well, I mean,
third place, for instance, I would call that pain compliance, but that's a face push.
No, it has a pain compliance element to it. No, you're right. Sorry, by face push, I mean like the
this
plate here. Oh, okay. I will hurt you under your chin so badly. It's a strike to the face.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
But you're right. It is similar in structure to the shears that we do. And the first six plays will have a pain compliance element to it if we're done at full force, for sure. But I'm talking specifically.
With the groin shot and the gear thing.
Yeah.
Exactly.
So I think we can mentally acknowledge that and move on rather than the head work. But yeah, so the escape from behind, one of the most singularly unhelpful pieces of text ever. This is a good hold to practice, but I can hold you without you being able to harm me. In the PD, he actually takes the part of the attacker. The scholar is the attacker. Mm-hmm. But in the Getty, it's the reverse. The Getty. Here it is. Okay, so in the Getty, the scholar is also the holder.
the situation is fairly unusual where you grapple someone so that he cannot defend himself. But here's the counter. If you are the one being held this way, go as soon as you can against the wall and pull the pheasant. You turn around so the opponent holding will break his head in back. Okay, so in the PD and in the Getty, the attacker is the scholar, but in the Getty, most of the instruction is for the victim.
This is probably a good question. It seems like you have somebody who's full body hands and a full mouth, but like, what do you do from there? Like, can you just like hang out with like this?
For hours.
Right. So,
call a friend.
This is why we're gonna be in two groups now. So, for that exact reason, I submit the purpose of this poll is for the friend. Not for me.
Be then conscious.
Or
for the scalable audience to stop.
That too.
Yeah. That's
true.
Friend, sorry. Yeah.
That too.
Stop it all.
Don't
do that.
Yeah.
Not least because only one side is needed for a decent mold. Give you some strength, right? And you're already behind them.
How does one side is
one too much, right? I can always, once I'm here, I can start striking, I can always grab the counters, stay behind, right? Draw my dagger, really mess up my
crowd.
So to intentionally do two and pull two, is I can clearly put the brand up for
when you did four then with this run from here, right?
You could. But I mean, there's other throws that you can do. There is actually a very dangerous throw. So there's a very dangerous throw where the back super difficult.
Okay.
Where like you're, fuck. It's.
He doesn't know what he's doing.
It's something to do with. Hold on.
It's very dangerous.
It's something to do with the head.
Yeah, don't do it.
It's something to do with the head. It may just be the position. Maybe being.
Oh.
It's something. It's
right the back of the head.
Maybe you put pressure on his neck and.
Yeah.
Pressure
press
him down.
It's something to do with the head. Spine compression here that you can get to it from a north-south position. You can do it on the ground. You can also do it from the throat. And being behind, you could potentially throw them in a way that.
So they're just fine then?
Yeah. But, all that said, right, it's wrestling's off as we do. I think the point of this project is for the friend. Now, the escape, let's ignore the wall thing, that's stupid. Obviously, you can do that, I guess. But even if you could do that, there's other things that are better, I think. So, as the hold is being set, before it's super set, sinking the weight, and getting here is the obvious thing. Once you're here, you can do an escape from behind, right? If there's space, I mean, you could also turn around, right? And all the other things that we want to do. And then, secondly, once the hold is set, we always have the option of stripping, right? Reach behind, find the fingers, and strip. And once you're here, you can get around too. So, I don't know. Those to me seem much more reasonable than the fucking find the wall tree thing. So I don't really know why you guys talk about that. So let's just try that. Let's try that. But here's the drill, though. Let's make it a little fun. So the drill will be: we'll divide the room in two. Divide the room in two.
Oh boy.
And what we're gonna do is our partner's gonna grab us from behind. And the friend is going to start at the end. Friend is going to start at, so go to the end of the room. Yeah. And as soon as the hold is on, you start walking towards us, and you've got to do the escape before he gets here.
Okay?
Yeah. And walk at a, walk at a normal pace, but go.
Oh, I'm going to kick your ass.
All right.
And then you can go into the next one. Infinite cycle of violence. Italian style.
Let's do it so
infinite
time. So we got people in line and somebody in the rotating.
So.
Yeah, and then I guess the person who walked down and then in the
get
in the
line,
and we'll cycle through it.
Yeah.
Okay?
Alright,
so. Alright. So we'll All right, you're back into another group. Okay, good.
Stanford's there.
All right. Yeah. Okay, let me take my glasses off. Oh! Just like in the
Greece. So, when we look, I'm going to put on like a foot shoulder.
Look, I want your footprint, right?
So I guess I mean we had.
Is that a karate chop? Okay.
So I got you eyes! Chest with equipment somewhere? I mean, you don't
have it. I haven't seen it.
I'm hoping for at least some equivalent storage, right? But you know, even here, technically, we could have a wrestling mat of some or some kind that could be rolled up and stashed neatly and brought out.
Or pieced out, pieced in.
So yeah, now I like the puzzle mats, I do, but the puzzle mat problem is that set up and take down its own. Right, as opposed to a whole piece wrestling mat.
Yeah.
So it would be cool to find a wrestling mat that's as firm as the puzzle mats, but that can be rolled out with one piece. I don't know.
It's cheap.
And
it's cheap. That's
not bad. One thing for the other.
Yeah, but let's put it out there. If anybody hears me, then we'll do it. Okay. So the next part of the afternoon is fencing. So we'll close and we'll start.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Thanks, Alan, for teaching.
My pleasure. I haven't been able to really be here for a week and a half, but I was really jonesing.
Oh, yeah, you got an over cold
cold. Yeah.
Was it this week or was it
last week? They almost put me on call this week because of the Rogers emergency.
Oh, yeah.
I refused.
Yeah. Do you think it got messed up for Scotia? Like, Interact was down, right?
Oh, lots of things were down, like, in terms of retail payments and things like that.
Yeah.
Online banking was down for Scotia, but that was common with all banks, so it was fine. But the problem for us was our emergency call routing system, which is through PagerDuty.
Yeah.
A program called PagerDuty. All of our phones are on Rogers plans.
Oh. Okay.
So we need the emergency system. If some cyber emergency happens at 2 in the morning, we need the system to be able to call us.
Mm.
And if we don't have it, we'll miss it, and that could be terrible. Yeah. So we were scrambling. I have my personal phone on the on-call system right now. But now that the crisis is over, we'll fix everything back.
Does anyone know what the fuck happened? Like, I was everything go down
In the morning. Everybody in the SOC was laughing at Rogers because we're like, this is for sure a change. This is for sure some junior,
some,
you know,
update.
Some update. Some like co-op student, you know, did something at 3 in the morning, and then boom, right? But the more and more the day went on, the more we're like,
that's bigger than
that.
There's no way they fucked up this bad.
Ransom.
If it was a change, then they would have fixed it.
Yeah.
This could be cyber. And so there were big cyber conspiracies by the end of the day.
Okay.
But apparently, the government formally ruled out cyber.
Okay. Oh, it's a bit early for that, isn't it?
Suspiciously early.
Yeah.
So I think, this is a little tit hat, but I think they did that to rule out speculation, or is it to control speculation?
Yeah, exactly.
But not because that's the real situation.
No trick planning.
Yeah.
It could be just a patch. Like, sometimes patches are hard to roll back.
Well, anyways, it started at 3 in the morning.
It's a fucking hidden comma somewhere.
But the thing is, they're supposed to have redundancies that make that pretty much impossible.
Well, let's put everything
through the computation.
Tell me about it.
Software.
Tell me about it.
I want to know some consistent tools and to find about it. And it was one of those commas that's visible in a certain language, but not visible in the most interesting
language. Oh, yeah, I commented out.
And it was like easily being like that.
Don't you check my one little spot. was a fix affecting people across the entire country.
Yeah, that was last night. I was working with.
When I was happy to see actually we had really good program, and they went to a Rogers and said,
just like, say, like, oh, this is fine to go. I'm like,
this is what they
tested.
There were a whole bunch of errors I made.
They'll get banned for sure.
So
fine. Well, it depends on the cause.
Okay.
If it's like, well, the statistic that I'm looking forward to is a comparison of millions lost in business to the total so far
lost by Russia from the Ukraine sanctions. I want to see how close those numbers are. I bet they're pretty close.
I don't think they're that close. Russia's eating shit. Like,
They
can make a lot of their own resources. But like, they don't have to distribute. Like, they're not set up to like only have logistics entirely internal.
What if you did?
Because that volume might be there for most things, not all things. Yeah. Which is also a problem.
Sure, they're gonna be perfect in my machine.
For Russia, that's another thing. They call people out of the office to be able to look at the data.
Canola and soy.
Mm-hmm.
We do like canola and soy.
Yeah, canola,
I think.
Soy. I think probably, honestly, it's like veggies and fruits. Mm-hmm. Our production period is like so short.
It's very seasonal.
Yeah. It's like when we have a friend that we're going to first start Russia, it's like, what do you think there's no like local veggies in June? Exactly. When you have land that's good enough for grass but not good enough for
yeah.
But then you need to produce enough hay to to like keep it alive in winter.
Yeah, the actual
you need a water
on the actual amount of land you need, if you're a free range grazing is quite significant compared to the number of cows you get from it. Apparently that would be the dust bowl, the American dust bowl was the cattle craze of the newly, I guess, conquered West. There was so much cattle grazing on the plains that they just wiped out the grasses and.
Oh, okay. But it wasn't the dust bowl. It was grassland.
It was lush grassland before. But yeah. My point is that the overgrazing
created
the dust bowl. So like the amount of sustainable cattle you get from acres of grass is not as much as you think.
Mm-hmm.
And being a farmer is really expensive these days. So like, you know, half a dozen cows for 500 acres or something is not going to.
Yeah, probably the main resource for farming today is probably debt. Yeah. The main resource for farming is debt. So.
I think it depends on what kind of farm. I think the main resource for like dairy farms is the card. Like you need a license for dairy because it's regulated, like the dairy board.
Hmm.
So they're actually still profitable, but it's like cab drivers, like.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that's unique to Canada. It's not everywhere has a dairy code. That's why all the international trade agreements hate Canada.
Yeah, we've been doing that. Humanity, like to the exclusion of other species, is like the use of metal.
Yeah.
Because it's like chimpanzees.